Let's talk about the camera in Devil May Cry 5 and third-person games in general. Of all the things that I thought might cause a stir in my DMC5 video, watch it here if you haven't seen it yet, the least of my worries were my statements about the camera. I felt like the short section mentioning my grievances would be fine, since it's just the camera we're talking about. The real important stuff is the design of the game and the combat. Turns out it wasn't fine, judging by how many people took issue with it. I could have been more detailed in my explanation, and actually I was planning to be. I had an entire section of that video dedicated to talking about the lock-on system, but I decided to cut it because I felt like it was dragging down the pacing of my video. Sometimes you gotta make those calls when you're making content that's supposed to be entertaining as well as information-focused. So I'm gonna take what I said in that video and the cut section and combine it with parts of discussions I've had with people in the comment section. This video isn't a response to any one person, though I've engaged with some more than others, and I'm in the mood to put these ideas together here. The first part of the video will talk about how camera direction is implemented in different games, and the second part will be specifically about DMC5 and the lock-on system and how it relates to camera management. You can skip to that part if you want, but it won't have the foundation to support it. The two main issues I have with the free-roaming camera in DMC5, and with any other melee-focused game that uses one, is that they all end up with the same presentation, and to me, it feels very tedious to always have the right thumbstick dedicated to camera movement. I'll start with the first issue. Two-dimensional games are pretty much all presented in the same way because it's a flat perspective. You can play around with 3D backgrounds and characters getting closer or further from the camera, but you're still presenting the games in the same visual form. The same goes for first-person games, whether they be shooters or adventure games or horror games, whatever. They're all using the same camera perspective. It's right there in the name, first person. And on a controller, the right thumbstick is needed to look around because these games rely on focusing your vision on the action and usually aiming guns. Games outside these two perspectives have a lot more freedom in the way they can be presented. You can have dramatic overhead views like this scene in DMC4, angular fixed cameras that follow the character's action in Ninja Gaiden, epic cinematic camera angles like some parts of the God of War series, static fixed camera like the classic Resident Evil games, flowing crane-like cameras like Silent Hill. Silent Hill is a great example of this actually, because camera angles don't only have to be about framing the action on screen. Camera movements can be used to set the mood of a scene. A camera swaying around like this can communicate disorientation and confusion of the protagonist. A pulled back camera can communicate loneliness. The right camera angle and lighting can enhance horror and tension. Camera direction can draw the player's attention to important items instead of having to make them glow brightly for players to notice them. It can also guide the player's direction by intelligently framing the navigation options instead of just wandering around and not knowing where you're going or where you started from. It also makes areas of the game more visually memorable. If you spend all day in a virtual reality environment, sure, it'll be an amazing visual experience, but the memory of that place won't have any artistic framing for your brain. That's why a picture, a still image, is so much easier to recall in detail. It's why when I think of the Spencer Mansion in Resident Evil 1, I can instantly recall every detail about this shot. There are so many ways to present your game artistically when you're not locked into 2D or first person. This is why I'm so disappointed by more and more games adopting a free-roaming camera. Around the time of the third console generation, we saw the rise of third-person shooters. The over-the-shoulder camera angle got popularized by Resident Evil 4, and then it was a tidal wave of games being made in that style. Dead Space, Metal Gear Solid 4, Uncharted, Tomb Raider, Quantum Break, Gears of War, and now your third-person battle royale games. And I get it, it works. You want to be able to see the world around you and where you're aiming. Having the character off-center allows for a better view of your target. But the downside to this streamlined approach is that they all start to feel similar. There's a homogenization of game design happening here, and I don't like it. I'm not saying that no game should use it, but even games that didn't used to have this presentation, like God of War, now do. Most of the new Resident Evil games have this camera now. New properties are constantly made in the style of free-roaming camera. Dark Souls, Bloodborne, The Witcher, Horizon, Nier. It's not a new thing. Look at Ocarina of Time and see that the game asks the player to control the camera. I'm not saying that this has never existed before. I'm saying that it's become so prevalent that it's like studios refuse to make games with anything other than this one camera style. There's so much potential behind using the camera in different ways, and I just think it's a real shame that nothing gets presented through intentional camera direction anymore. DMC5 is just another game in a series that follows this trend. If you don't have a problem with that, or you think it makes DMC play better compared to the other games in the series, fine. I'm not here to compare DMC games to each other in terms of camera. I'm looking at it as one in a long line of games that has had its presentation streamlined. I recommend checking out a fantastic video by Neryl on Resident Evil 2 Remake and fixed camera angles, if you're interested in further understanding the functions of smart camera direction in games. The larger part of my issue with this camera style is that I simply find it tedious to manage. Going all the way back to Super Mario 64, a legendary and incredible game that has the player regularly tapping the camera buttons to adjust the angle to better frame the action. I didn't like this camera management stuff back then, and I don't like it now. Mario 64 is still a great game, but I don't like being responsible for the camera. Now, action games are overwhelmingly played with controllers, and action games require a lot of different button presses. It's not a third-person shooter where 90% of your button presses are aim and shoot. No, we're dealing with multiple attack buttons, jump, grab, roll, block, dash, magic, and whatever else you want to throw on top. It's precisely for that reason that I don't like moving the camera around with my right thumb. I'd rather be able to focus 100% on the buttons I need to be pressing. This is why I mention God of War when I talk about this style of camera. God of War has the player using the four face buttons and the triggers very frequently, and having to move the camera would be a distraction from that. So the right stick instead serves a very useful function, being the roll command. You can press the right stick in any direction to execute a roll in that direction. So you're using the right stick for something, but your thumb isn't on it that much in moment-to-moment gameplay, whether it's combat, exploration, or platforming. So DMC5 has this free-roaming camera. If you're not turning the camera, you can't navigate the worlds you're running through. I mean, I guess you could, but it's awkward as hell. And you certainly won't be doing that on your first playthrough because you don't know these environments and you need to look around to figure out where you're going. I don't like it, it's a personal thing, I think it makes games all look the same. If it doesn't bother you, fine. It bothers me, so I'm gonna say it. As for the camera during combat, DMC5 isn't nearly as bad as God of War 2018. That's why I was brief in my comments about it. God of War's camera is zoomed in tight like a third-person shooter. You can't see what's behind you, and you pretty much never stop moving the camera. I hate it. DMC5's lock-on feature can reduce the amount that the player has to move the camera. If there are no enemies in front of you and you press lock-on, you'll spin around and the camera focuses on what was previously behind you. That is true, but it's not the whole picture. There's a finicky nature to lock-on. Pushing the left stick in the direction of your intended target does not guarantee that you'll lock onto them. The game chooses who the best lock-on target is, even if you don't want it. If there are multiple enemies on screen and you lock onto someone you don't want, you click the left stick several times to cycle through targets. You can't control which way the cycling goes by moving the stick in that direction. And if you tilt the left stick to move when you're trying to cycle targets, the cycling process will stop because you're not allowed to move while changing targets. Why? You could move and change targets in DMC3, why take away that function here? If there's three enemies in front of you, and one next to you, and one behind you, and you decide you want to focus on the guy behind you because he's dangerous, your choice is to either swing the camera around manually to reframe the action, or press lock on, cycle three targets in front of you, and the guy next to you until you get turned around. So, intentionally changing targets is already a sloppy affair. But accidentally changing targets is much worse. Since the game decides the target for you, releasing lock-on and repressing it is a huge gamble. If you launch an enemy into the air and do a little combo, and then for whatever reason you let go of lock-on, and then you press it again, sometimes the game will lock on to a different enemy on the ground, even though there's an enemy right in front of you in the air. Why would you release lock-on in mid-air when you're comboing an enemy? I don't know, maybe it happens by accident. Or you're not used to it yet because you're a new player. Or you're playing Nero, who requires you to release lock-on every time you use a Devil Breaker because if you don't release it, you do the wire snatch move. So you'll release lock-on to use a Devil Breaker, lock-on again, and get a completely different target. To quote my DMC playing buddy Zazman, the lock-on system in DMC5 is at best functional and at worst actively detrimental. Moving on to the next part of the camera lock-on issue, I think a lot of people are not taking into account the experience of new players. DMC4 came out 11 years before DMC5. There's gonna be a lot of people coming into DMC5 with no experience. So all this nonsense like, LOL, why are you playing DMC5 if you haven't played the other games, is ridiculous. Players at my level, and better and worse, are gonna play this game. And you cannot expect a new player to master this inconsistent lock-on system on their first playthrough. They're gonna have to depend on the option to move the camera manually. That's what I meant when I said that you have to constantly move the camera. It's not an inaccurate portrayal of the first-time player's experience. Go find any new player's video footage of them playing the game for the first time and you'll see constant camera swinging. Responding to this by saying you actually never have to move the camera in combat due to lock-on is a bit disingenuous and doesn't apply at all to the experience of a lot of players, who are people who will play the game once, twice, maybe three times, because the vast amount of people who play games don't dive in deeper than that, and that audience is important. So yes, by that standard, you have to frequently manage the camera during combat in DMC5, because I'm not going to judge the game based on people who have already mastered it, especially when the game's lack of a challenging difficulty level at the start greatly contributes to this issue. If your solution to the constant camera movement during combat is the mastery of the lock-on ability, then it's a catastrophic failure that the game doesn't let players choose a hard difficulty that would encourage them to use that ability. Devil May Cry 5 forces new players to play on normal before unlocking hard. And don't you dare tell me about unlocking Son of Sparta through the Urizen fight. I already said that's not a justification for locking it away. You'd only know to do that if you'd read about it, and you can't expect new players to know that's a thing, much less defeat a powerful boss that only an experienced DMC player is gonna figure out that early. And no, DMC5 is not so special that the hard difficulty needs to be hidden away from players to protect them, while hard is available to new players of any other game. Lock away Dante Must Die if you have to, not the first difficulty that starts to challenge the player. It's quite strange to hear people say that Son of Sparta needs to be hidden from new players, or else they'll pick it and have a bad time if they're not good enough. Why would a new player who doesn't want a challenge pick the hard difficulty? Are you saying that no game should have a hard option for new players, or just Devil May Cry? Anyway, the point is, Devil Hunter is easily passed by playing the game badly. I played it badly because there's no reward for good play outside of an arbitrary style meter that doesn't affect your success in the campaign. Other players will play it badly because the game lets them get away with their bad habits. Others will play badly just because they're no good and they want to play on easy and have a fun casual time. That's okay too. But the common thread is that the game isn't doing anything to make lock-on important to your game plan. If the game gives you 100,000 orbs at the start, making it unnecessary to do stylish combos to earn orbs to unlock upgrades, and if enemies do such low damage and have such low health, and if just mashing the attack button is just as successful as doing a stylish combo using lock-on, then new players aren't gonna get good at using lock-on to mitigate the issues of the free-roaming camera in combat. This is why in my first video, the footage from my first playthrough shows me not using lock-on at all, and the footage from my later playthroughs on higher difficulties and Bloody Palace shows me using lock-on a lot. The game was finally at a point where playing well had a tangible effect on progress, so lock-on became very useful and the camera was less of a problem. And if the game had been challenging from the start, I never would have had this issue. Or if the style meter actually meant something in-game other than just an ego boost and weren't so easy to fill due to how forgiving DMC5 is regarding its style meter mechanics. So not only is the lock-on ability inconsistent and tedious at times, the game utterly fails at pushing a player into playing the game well, which would translate into using said inconsistent lock-on to better manage the camera. The lock-on inconsistencies and general wonky design doesn't mitigate camera issues as much as it could. New players will not be masters at lock-on and will therefore need to be using the manual camera a lot. And the game's lack of a challenging difficulty leads to players not even learning the lock-on system because it's not even needed since bad play is rewarded. Whew, wow, that was exhausting. And fun. I really enjoy talking about this stuff and thinking about games and why I feel the way I do about them. I'm working on another video like this that talks about games pushing you into their systems through challenge, and that's really exciting. Like and subscribe and all that, follow me on Twitch, support me on Patreon, comment below, and just keep doing whatever you do. Thanks for watching.